Okay, now let's start with the last topic of the applied thermodynamics, that is IC engine or internal combustion engine. So there are three cycles in internal combustion engine: Otto cycle, diesel cycle and dual cycle. Otto cycle is for petrol engines and diesel cycle for diesel engines. Otto cycle is the combination of both Otto and diesel cycle. Okay. Now Otto cycle or a spark ignition, it is also called. Otto engines are known as a spark ignition. Okay. So Otto cycle comprises of four processes in which adiabatic compression and adiabatic expansion are there, then constant addition, constant volume heat addition and constant volume heat rejection. Now the graph is shown. It's a clockwise cycle, work producing cycle. Okay. Clearance ratio C is equal to clearance volume by swept volume. Swept volume is equal to pi by 4 d square l. D is the bore diameter or cylinder diameter. Length is l is the length of a stroke, which is equal to 2 into radius. R is the crank radius. Okay. L is equal to 2R. 2R means R is the crank radius. Compression ratio R is a different thing. It does not confuse with the same R. It's a different R. It's a radius. Now compression ratio R or volumetric compression ratio is equal to V1 by V2 is equal to V1 is Vs plus Vc, swept volume plus clearance volume, and V2 is clearance volume. Okay. So this is the Otto cycle. Now expansion ratio, expansion is done from 3 to 4, so expansion ratio is V4 by V3. Efficiency of Otto cycle is 1 minus compression ratio to the power gamma minus 1, 1 minus 1 by R gamma minus 1, R is the compression ratio, gamma is the ratio of specific heats or adiabatic index. Okay. Now for maximum net work output, T2 is equal to T4 is the geometric mean of T1 and T3. Okay. Means T2 is equal to T4 under root is equal to under root T1 into T3. Now net work output is equal to heat supplied minus heat rejected, because net work output is equal to net heat interaction is equal to heat supplied minus heat rejection. Okay. Now both heat supplied and heat rejection are done at constant volume, so Cv is there, Cv into delta T. Okay. Now diesel cycle. So as you have seen in Otto cycle, that heat addition is done at constant volume and also heat rejection is done at constant volume. But in diesel cycle, heat addition is done at constant pressure, while the heat rejection is done as the constant volume. Same as the Otto cycle, heat rejection is done at constant volume, but here heat addition is done at constant pressure. Okay. So these are the terms: swept volume, clearance volume. Okay. Now same as before, compression ratio is same, expansion ratio is same, but here we get another ratio, that is cutoff ratio rho is equal to V3 by V2. Okay. Now efficiency of the diesel engine is equal to 1 minus 1 by R gamma minus 1. Okay. Same as the Otto cycle, 1 minus 1 by R gamma minus 1. But slight modification is here, that it's not just 1 by R gamma minus 1. It's an additional rho to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma into rho minus 1. Rho is the cutoff ratio. Okay. Now in any question, if you are given that cutoff take place as 10% of a stroke, it means that V3 minus V2 is equal to 0.1 into V1 minus V2. Okay. Now this is the cycle. Once again, we have dual cycle. Okay. Now in dual cycle, heat addition is done at both constant pressure and constant volume, while the heat rejection is done only at constant volume. Okay. So this is the dual cycle here. For heat addition, we have two cycles. One is at constant volume, another at constant pressure, while the heat rejection is only at constant volume, and expansion and contraction, expansion on compression or reversible adiabatic. Once again, it's Vs and this is Vc. Now cutoff ratio is equal to V3 by V2, expansion ratio is equal to V4 by V3, and compression ratio is the multiplication of expansion and cutoff ratio, is equal to V1 by V2. Efficiency of this dual cycle we are not concerned with because it is not asked in gate examinations. Otherwise, you can find it. You can find the heat supplied and heat rejected from the data given. So you can find out that. Now, in IC engine, as we have seen, that whatever the ratio are coming, they are volume ratio, not pressure ratio. Okay. So in IC engine, we use volume ratio, not pressure ratio, and all the volume ratios are always greater than one. Now this is an additional data to be used in numericals, that 1 dm³ is equal to 1 liter, or 1 m³ is equal to 1000 liter. Okay, this is one decimeter cube is equal to 1 liter, implies 1 m³ is equal to 1000 liter. Okay, this is for water. Okay. Now, a specific heat at constant pressure is equal to gamma into R by gamma minus 1, and for constant volume, it's R into R by gamma minus 1. Okay. We have already seen in thermodynamics these concepts. Now, mean effective pressure. Mean effective pressure is used to calculate the brake power, indicated power, or power output. Okay. So, mean effective pressure is equal to area of the indicator diagram by the length of the indicator diagram into a spring constant. Okay. And net work output of the cycle is equal to mean effective pressure into swept volume. Okay. Now the net work output may be indicated power or brake power. So according to the demand that we are getting, whether it's indicated power, we will use indicated mean effective pressure, and for brake power we will use brake mean effective pressure. Now cylinder volume is equal to volume between top dead center and bottom dead center. Okay, means swept volume plus clearance volume is equal to V1. Okay, now total volume of the cylinder is equal to number of cylinders into V1. In two-stroke engine, one cycle is completed in 2 strokes. That is, power stroke we get in 1 revolution. Now, 2n strokes means n cycles, means n revolutions, and means n power cycles. Okay. For 4 stroke, we get 1 power stroke in 2 revolutions. Okay. And one cycle is completed in 4 strokes. Means 4n strokes is equal to n cycles, is equal to 2n revolutions, is equal to n power strokes. Okay. Now scavenging is the getting out of the exhaust gases from the fresh fuel coming in. Okay. Now 2-stroke engine, once again, 1 revolution, 1 cycle. It's a lighter engine, lighter flywheel, cheaper cost, greater cooling, and lubrication is required for 2-stroke engine, and it uses mist lubrication system. Okay. Now comparison between otto cycle and diesel cycle. Otto cycle is also known as a spark ignition, and diesel cycle is known as compressed ignition. Okay. Now otto cycle uses carburetor, while diesel cycle uses fuel pump or diesel engine cycle, not engine. So auto engine or petrol engine uses carburetor, while the diesel engine uses fuel pump. For the ignition temperature required for the combustion is high for petrol engine, while the ignition temperature required for diesel engine is less. Pressure ratio is less for petrol engine, while the pressure ratio is higher for diesel engine. Efficiency of the petrol engine is less and efficiency of diesel engine is high. Now, petrol engines are lightweight while the diesel engines are heavyweight. And knocking occurs in auto engines after ignition, while in diesel engines the knocking occurs before ignition. Okay, what is knocking? We will study it in the further video. Now, for the same compression ratio, efficiency of the auto cycle is the most, in between is the dual cycle and least is the diesel cycle. Okay, so for the same compression ratio, we have efficiency of the auto cycle as maximum and efficiency of the diesel cycle as the least, while dual cycle is in between. For all other criteria like heat supplied, heat rejected or anything like that, we have efficiency of the diesel as the greatest and efficiency of the petrol engine as the least, while dual cycle is in between. Now, indicated power is equal to brake power plus frictional power. Okay, indicated power is equal to I into mean effective pressure into length of a stroke into area of cross section into number of revolutions. So for 4 strokes, IP is equal to IPM LAN by 60. For 4 stroke, it's IPM LAN by 2 into 60. Why N by 2? Because in 4 strokes, for every 2 revolutions, we get a power stroke. Okay, so it's N by 2. Okay, I is the number of cylinder, PM is the mean effective pressure or indicated mean effective pressure, L is the length of the stroke, A is the area of cross section, A is and N is the number of RPMs. Now LAN by 60 is equal to swept volume in meter cube per second. Okay, or if it's a 4 stroke engine, it will be 60 into 2 because N by 2 will be there, na? So LAN by 60 for 2 stroke and LAN by 2 into 60 for 4 stroke. Now brake power is equal to 2 pi NT 60 and 2 pi NT 2 pi N by 2 into 60 for 4 stroke. Okay, it's just torque into omega. Okay, T is the torque and 2 pi N by 60 is omega. Okay, for 4 stroke it's N by 2, so torque into omega is also there for 4 stroke. So T is the torque on the crank, which is equal to F into R. F is the mass into gravity, which is reading of the dynamometer, and R is the radius of the dynamometer. Okay, M is the mass of the dynamometer, you can say, or mass attached to the dynamometer. Okay, or maybe the power, maybe the weight that the engine is carrying out. So this is M. So torque is equal to F into R. F is the reading of the dynamometer and R is the radius of the dynamometer. M is the mass that has been pulled by the engine. G is the gravity, 9.81 meter per second square. Now N is the RPM of the crank. BP is the brake power. It's not BREAK, it's BRAKE. Okay, brake power. I've written it wrong. So BRAKE, brake power. IP is the indicated power, FP is the friction power or the power lost in friction. Volumetric efficiency is equal to actual volume by soft volume. Brake specific fuel consumption is equal to mass of the fuel by brake power. Indicated specific fuel consumption is mass flow rate by indicated power. The unit is kilogram per kilowatt hour. Okay. Now fuel by air ratio is equal to mass of fuel by mass of air. If you are given the density of air, you can find it by density of air into actual volume is equal to MA. Now energy provided to the cylinder is mass flow rate of fuel into calorific value of the fuel. Okay, CV is the calorific value of the fuel. Now testing of IC engine means we will compute mechanical efficiency using these three methods. So first method is Williamson method, where we plot the mass flow rate on y-axis and brake power on x-axis, and we plot the graph and we get the frictional power on the negative x-axis while brake power on the positive x-axis, and we have y-axis for mass flow rate of the fuel. So we get that line, and from that line we get these values. Okay, second one is the motor test. Here the motor is used to run the engine, and the engine is at the condition when it's not firing, means the engine is not operating at that time. So we get the frictional power of the engine using the power consumed by the motor. So this is the efficiency of the motor and this is the power of the motor. Okay, because actually how much power is given into the engine is the we are concerned with. Okay, so we get the frictional power using this motor test. Okay, now third one is the MORS test, which is the most useful one, which the numericals are asked on this question. So MORS test is we calculate IP values for different number of cylinders as we have in the IC engine. So IP1 is the value we get when we subtract the brake power minus the power that we are getting when one engine is not operating. So IP1 is the power with all engines firing minus number one engine is not firing. IP2 is all engine firing minus number two engine is not firing. IP3 is all engine firing minus number three engine is not firing, means one engine are not firing in each of the cases. In first case it's the number one engine, in second case it's a number two engine, for third case it's a number three engine, and so on. So we will get the summation of these IPI values. Okay, summation of IPI values is the IP or indicated power, while the thing that is they have given all engine firing is the brake power. Okay, now mechanical efficiency is equal to brake power by indicated power, and indicated power is the summation of brake power plus frictional power. Now as we are discussing knocking, the knocking is also known as detonation or pinging. This causes vibration in the engine. Okay, so how this knocking happens? Knocking happens that the fuel gets accumulated and auto ignites before the original ignition takes place. Okay, so the flame reaches the last unburnt mixture and the mixture auto ignites. Okay, this is called knocking. It happens when the delay period is large, fuel accumulates, and when this fuel auto ignites due to high pressure, knocking occurs. Okay, so ignition is not happening while the fuel is getting accumulated. Okay, and the pressure is rising, so the fuel auto ignites even before the real ignition takes place, and it causes knocking. Okay, because due to the increase in pressure. Now for knocking we have octane number and cetane number. So octane number is used for auto engines and cetane number is used for compressed ignition engine or diesel engine. Okay, so 100% octane number means zero knock in SI engine, 100% cetane number means zero knock in CI engines. Okay, now we can compute cetane number from octane number or octane number from cetane number using this formula. Is equal to cetane number is equal to 104 minus octane number by 2.5. okay, now octane number is the percentage of isooctane in the mixture of isooctane and in heptane. Okay, which gives the same knocking intensity as the fuel which has been tested. It can be increased by adding TEL triethyl lead. Okay, you can increase the octane number by adding triethyl lead. Okay, now we have cetane number. So it is the percentage of cetane C16H34 in the mixture of cetane and alpha methyl naphthalene C10H7CH3, which gives 100% NOC. This alpha methyl naphthalene gives 100% NOC. Okay, so it is the mixture of, it is the percentage of cetane C16H34 in the mixture of cetane and alpha methyl naphthalene which gives the same intensity of knocking as the fuel to be tested. Now we have supercharging and turbocharging. Okay, so turbocharging is nothing but supercharging done by the centrifugal compressor. So what is supercharging? So supercharging is increasing the density of air to increase the engine power output. Okay, it increases detonation in petrol engine and decreases detonation or knocking in compressed ignition engine. Okay, it provides better scavenging, means releasing out the exhaust gases when the new fuel comes. Okay, and it also gives reduced exhaust gas temperature and low specific fuel consumption. Okay, so these are the advantages of supercharging, that detonation is decreased in CI engine, better scavenging in for both, reduced exhaust gas pressure, exhaust gas temperature, and low specific fuel consumption. Now we have turbocharging. So in turbocharging, a turbine is driven by the exhaust of gases to drive a centrifugal compressor. Okay, and which the centrifugal compressor provides the supercharging. Okay, so if the exhaust of gases are used to drive a turbine which drives a centrifugal compressor for the supercharging of CI engine. Okay, now this is nothing but supercharging only, but we are using a centrifugal compressor which has been driven by the turbine and which is driven by the exhaust of the gases that we are getting. Okay, so same as the supercharging effect, this also fuel specific consumption decreases, output increases, same as that. So reduced exhaust gas temperature, fuel consumption becomes less. Okay, now we have balancing of the equation because we would be requiring this. So while balancing, because a hydrocarbon combustion of the hydrocarbon we are concerned with, so first we balance the carbon, then we balance the hydrogen by adding H2O in the deficient side, then we balance oxygen by adding O2 in the deficient side, and we can use fraction for that. Okay, if you are requiring only O, okay, if you are requiring only O on one side, so half O2 would be there. Okay, similarly for hydrogen also, if you are requiring only one hydrogen, so you will add half H2O. okay, now in the final equation you will get rid of this fraction 1/2 or 3/4, anything you would be doing this, so you will get rid of this fraction by multiplying the whole equation by a suitable factor. So first of all, balance carbon, then balance then balance hydrogen by adding the fractional H2O or whole H2O in the deficient side, or the multiples of H2O in the deficient side, then balance oxygen by adding fractional oxygen, whole oxygen, or multiple oxygen in the deficient side, and use fractions as I have said, and this then in the final get rid of this fraction by multiplying the whole equation by a suitable factor. Okay, there should be a no fraction in the final equation. Now the complete combustion gives carbon dioxide and water. If you are asked complete combustion, then complete combustion is CO2 and H2O. Now to control pollution, that we use following measures because IC engine produced pollution, because unburned carbon monoxide would be there, NOx would be there, many problems are there. So we can control pollution using increasing the supply of oxygen, because by doing supercharging, then exhaust gas recirculation as happens in turbocharging, then use of thermal converter, that thermal converter converts, provides extra combustion and converts carbon monoxide into carbon dioxide, or it can break the NOx into nitrogen and oxygen. Okay, we can also use catalytic converter. So catalytic converter also does the same thing like thermal converter, that it converts carbon monoxide into carbon dioxide, NOx into nitrogen and oxygen respectively. So how many catalytic converters we use? So catalytic converters are used are platinum, rhodium and palladium. Okay, so platinum is used for hydrocarbons and it converts the hydrocarbons into, or the hydrocarbon combustibles into oxygen, into carbon dioxide and waters. Now rhodium converts NOx into nitrogen and oxygen, and palladium converts carbon monoxide into carbon dioxide. Okay, these are the catalytic converters that we use. Now we have equivalence ratio. Equivalence ratio is the ratio of actual fuel by air ratio to the ideal fuel air ratio. Okay, ideal is also known as stoichiometric. Okay, means you are completely balanced equation you are getting. So equivalence ratio is the ratio of actual fuel air ratio to the ideal fuel air ratio. Okay, now equivalence ratio is more than 1 for peak power condition or idling condition. Okay, so even if the machine is running at the peak power, equivalence ratio would be more than 1. And even if it's an idling condition, means the machine is not moving ahead, just you are started the engine and left it there, so still at that condition equivalence ratio would be more than 1. Now if you are getting equivalence ratio less than 1, it means the power output is less and the temperature of the charge is less. Now in SI engine it's just a common sense that octane number is high and cetane number is low. In CI engine, cetane number is high and octane number is low. For supercharged engines, volumetric efficiency is more than 1. Okay, by supercharging we get volumetric efficiency more than 1. Now we will see three cycles. So first of all, the Stirling cycle. So if an ideal gas turbine or Brayton cycle with intercooling, reheating and regeneration, the number of compression and expansion cycles are increased, it becomes a Stirling cycle whose efficiency is equal to that of the Carnot cycle. Okay, now we'll draw the graph of these three cycles, Stirling, Erickson and Atkinson. Okay, they are not related to IC engine, but they are all related to thermodynamics. They are asked in the examination, so we'll read this. Okay, so this is the Stirling cycle. This is same as that Otto cycle, that constant volume addition and constant volume heat rejection is there. Okay, but instead of adiabatic expansion and compression, we are having isothermal expansion and compression. Okay, however we are saying that in Brayton we are getting a Stirling cycle from Brayton cycle, but the graph is like Otto cycle. Okay, now Erickson cycle has a graph like Brayton cycle. Okay, that the heat addition and heat compression is done at isobaric, means constant pressure, while unlike that in Brayton cycle, we have expansion and compression in adiabatic. Here in Ericsson cycle, expansion and compression are isothermal. Okay, now we have Atkinson cycle, which is same like Otto cycle or reciprocal of the Otto cycle. It's not Otto cycle, it's reciprocal of the Otto cycle, in which we are getting expansion and compression adiabatic, while heat addition at constant volume and heat rejection at constant pressure. So thank you, it's over.